We will continue with our second distinguished speaker. Ambassador Thomas Pickering has had one of the most remarkable careers in history of the U.S. Foreign Service. Seven times an ambassador to six countries at critical periods in their history. Jordan, Nigeria, El Salvador, Israel, India, and Russia, as well as the United Nations during the first Gulf War. Ambassador Pickering truly deserves his reputation as a polymath and expert on virtually every topic under discussion today. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Pickering.
Thank you, Dania, for that very kind, if just a little bit exaggerated introduction. One is always happy to see those when they come. And thank you, too, for your very kind invitation to come and speak to you today. I welcome you all, ahlan wa sahlan, to the world capital of tranquility, celerity, and repose. For those of you tired of the exigencies and uncertainties of the Middle East, I know Washington is a welcome break. I want to talk about the region from an American perspective, and I want to talk about it from the point of view that what might be done to deal with the region in the future, rather than the endless and intricate problem of recounting all of the foils, failures, and difficulties of the past. Undoubtedly, some of the latter will intrude. It's almost impossible to avoid. The region has been, for us in the United States, of remarkable and consuming interest, and will be, in my view, for some great time to come. It is, in many ways, a crossroads of the world, a region which at one point the Obama administration hoped to swerve away from, but was never able to do so. A region that our allies and friends around the world depend heavily upon for their energy, and which we may in the future return to. A region which is at the center of, in fact, the production and introduction of gas in a more intensive way to help in its own fashion to deal with the challenges of global warming and climate change. And a region whose major output, unfortunately for the moment, seems to be a crescendo of conflict, something that clearly is neither in the region's interests nor that of the United States. It is, I think, important as we look at the region to understand that the United States, having tried and failed in at least two major occasions to use military force to solve the diplomatic problems of the region, is once again thrown back on the problems that will have to be resolved, I believe, through diplomacy as much as anything else. Military force alone produces combat victories, but combat victories do not automatically produce political settlements, particularly settlements that will endure. And so those of you who invest and those of you who look for answers, beware of the super fascination with the simplicity of a military resolution. Secondly, I believe it is extremely important, particularly in the region, that a country like the United States, which has shown an increasing wariness of involvement, becomes once again involved. The players in the region and the extra-regional players have shown no sign of being able to produce an answer, either militarily or diplomatically. I'm not sure that an active role by the United States will change it, but I am sure that without it, we are stuck, and I believe it is worth trying. Were the present administration able to undertake that kind of activity, I believe it would show real results. I want to say just a few words about three major problem areas in the region and some of the possibilities for the future. It will be based on a certain assumption of optimism, which is entirely, put it this way, undeserved at the present time. But nevertheless, we have to hew in that direction if we are going to produce results that can endure and resolve. I want to look at Iran, at Syria, and if there is time today, at Yemen. Neither of these three is particularly easy. Each of them is intricate. Each of them involves links with the other in one way or another. Each of them is at the heart of conflict, much of it informed, unfortunately, by galloping Sunni, Shia, and Arab-Persian differences. And much of it, in one way or another, is at the point where its capacity to be complex is unlimited, and where that growing complexity is a fertile seedbed for generating even more complexity to follow if we don't deal with it. In Iran, my sense is that the military attack against Abqaiq and Hurais in Saudi Arabia and the failure to respond is a point of inflection. Certainly something that the news media in Washington finds impossible to avoid on a daily basis. But it is serious. And it's serious for a very simple reason. While many ignore it, and many more would like to move away from it, war in the Middle East by accident, misjudgment, miscalculation, and misperception around Iran's growing confidence that President Trump so does not want war, that he will continue to resile from the use of force as they raise the use of force consequences. And Iran has moved from surrogate activities against us and our Arab friends to almost direct activities, and will move away further. And we are facing the third stage of Iraq's upping the ante on their change in their obligations under the Joint Comprehensive Program of Action, from raising the volume of enrichment and the quality of enrichment to going past the danger line of 20%. These are, my view, very difficult things. What is interesting and I think important is that within the last 3 weeks, with the intervention of France, we have seen a really serious growing interest on President Trump participating in a high-level meeting with leaders of Iran. And while the Iranian result has, in my view, been a failure so far, it is also quite clear that President Rouhani, while he locked himself in his bedroom to avoid a call from President Trump at the last minute, was ready under conditions to make such an agreement possible. And that condition was very simply that the United States would commit publicly, in writing if possible, to the relief of sanctions imposed on Iran since 2017 in return for Iran going back to full compliance with the JCPOA, and both of them agreeing to have, as a result of that kind of an arrangement, an almost instantaneous summit meeting. Now, for those of you who have high confidence that President Trump can handle summits and produce results, one only has to look at the parlous record of the North Koreans. On the other hand, we had French help and we had wisdom about what could be agreed as the first step for the first time. And for that, I hold on to as a scintilla of hope in the process. It would be a long time for the U.S. and Iran to agree on something. But changing the kinetic possibilities of escalation is at this time extremely important. If you think you can figure out Syria and the new Turkish involvement And which is the Trump policy, Turkey in or Turkey out, more power to you? My sense is that inviting Turkey in was a serious error, and I believe Mr. Trump understands that, having saddled Vice President Pence and Secretary of State Pompeo with the unenviable task of arriving in Ankara this morning to bring about some resolution, perhaps a ceasefire, while at the very same time, while they were in the air, he did his best to undermine their negotiating capacities. Not a happy task. But I do think it is extremely important that Turkish intervention should be, if not returned, should be very limited. It opens the door for the Russians to bargain on something, and we have, by choice, decided to stay out. I'm not sure where they will go, but I would be a lot more comfortable if we were engaged. Bringing Assad back into northeastern Syria was a classic and seriously bad result, in my view, of what it was that we were undertaking to do, whether it was phase one Trump or phase two Trump. And my sense is we need to avoid that in the future. That will be very difficult. And if there is not going to be a war between the Kurds and the Turks, because something can be fixed with a small Turkish engagement in northern Syria, perhaps monitored by Russia and the United States under the UN, we have inevitably a serious possibility of a war between Kurds and Assad, to say nothing of the mixture of difficulty of the Islamic State taking advantage of this problem as rapidly and, I think, unfortunately, as spontaneously as it can. That will once again require those who oppose the malign role of the Islamic State to engage themselves in northern Syria and perhaps northern Iraq to prevent it. This is not an easy path to tread, and it is one fraught with difficulties. And it is one, in my humble view, as I said a moment ago, which will not be resolved by the players in the region now engaged without the United States. And I wish I could tell you I saw some kind of green light for American engagement, but maybe that will emerge in Ankara. We can always hope. Yemen is a massive problem. More people being killed and made refugees as time goes on. And with great apologies to my Saudi friends, little sense of real accomplishment in the military activity. And a strong commitment by the United Nations and my friend Martin Griffith to bring about a solution, but at this point, no significant way ahead. I was pleased, maybe this is divisive and unnecessary, but I was pleased to see the United Arab Emirates turn on a bright light and somehow conclude that they were not gaining very much by being engaged in Yemen. One can only hope that the two Mohammeds will speak together with some celerity in recognizing what is clearly, at this point, a non-manageable problem continuing in many ways to cause difficulties. In that direction lies a possibility of putting Yemen together, not a Yemen dominated by Houthis, but not a Yemen without a role for Houthis. These are difficult and really trying problems, but there is a willingness on my part, including even in Iran, which prides itself on profiting in a very serious way for what it considers to be a serious mistake among Yemen's neighbors in engaging in the first place. And Saudi Arabia has a serious interest in Yemen, but that's an interest that so far, again in my humble view, has not shown to be requited by the engagement in a military sense. So I told you I was an optimist. I am an optimist. I told you there were ways forward. There are ways forward. Unfortunately, I've also told you that there are no military solutions, but we continue to hew to that line in many things we are doing mistakenly. I will also argue that diplomatic solutions require military reinforcement, as it does sanctions pressure and other means of leverage in bringing about solutions to the problem. But there has to be, in my humble view, diplomatic engagement to make use of those pressures to formulate the kind of outcome with which the parties over time can be brought with which to live. A very difficult challenge. Military pressure alone, and it is a preoccupation of mine because we seem to be swerving away from more useful methods, even if they're not perfect. Military action alone is something which, in my sense, brings you into what I like to call the bluff trap. And the bluff trap is very simply, escalating military pressure has only two results. You either back down or you go to war. And neither of those is very optimistically what we would seek for. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for listening. Thank you, even after a wonderful meal, I hope for not sleeping through too much of this. It's been a pleasure to be with you.